And hosting the extraordinary achievements of our pupils in the world of STEM, and I would also argue also the world of STEAM, very important that AI field, and the impact that they have had. I'm not going to go into many details because I could, but I'm going to save that for the people to tell you themselves. So I mentioned impact. I think it's really important. Obviously, Groyne High is a school for girls. And we really need to empower them and ensure that the impact of what they've achieved is far-reaching. On your tables, you will see pupil designs from the payloads that went up. This is a competition that we ran in the school. And you'll be able to see pupils from our youngest year were successful, as well as people in older years. And I think over there, on that board to my right, you will see all the other designs. And as well as that, you'll see, and I've got mine here, just sort of dangling this, Ivy League here went to the edge of space in one of the payloads. And I think a lot of our astrogators, look at them, they're just winding them around their neck. I can see them are also wearing their Ivy League tonight. And just so you're aware, Ivy is a huge part of Groyne High. Our founding headmistress, the suffragette Dorinda Nelligan, made sure that on the girls' first prize giving, she grabbed some ivy from the school grounds and told them to wear it in their hair with pride that they're Groyne High girls. So it only seems apt and fitting that we are wearing our Croydon High ivy with pride tonight, aren't we? So when I was thinking about writing a speech for tonight's event, my mind actually wandered back to the very beginnings of when I first met the pupils of Astrogazers. I had perhaps been in post for a month. I started in September 2022, when an email was received asking if the Astrogazers could come present an idea to our senior leadership team. Now, I have to be honest with you, I love getting those emails here at Croydon High School because it's that empowerment. We do encourage people to reach out and be proactive in achieving their goals. And I remember a small group of people representing the Astrogazers came to the office to present to the senior team, probably around 12 of us around the board table. And from the moment they began to talk, the passion, the dedication and aspiration to reach their goal was apparent. They told me they wanted to launch their very own weather balloon. They did explain to me what it was. I'm a musician, I was very grateful for that. And they wanted funding to help them start the journey to get there. The professionalism with which they presented really impressed us all, and we had no choice. We definitely wanted to support them. And so from there started a phenomenal journey. And we are so fortunate to have enlisted the support and wisdom of the team at the University of Bath. There is absolutely no way this journey would have got off the ground without them. Excuse the pun. And I'd like to take this opportunity personally to thank Catherine Mitchell and Robert Watson. Can we just wave in that sort of awkward way we all enjoy? Yes. Wonderful colleagues who really supported the team. I have to say, Mrs. Karteepan speaks so highly, and we're very grateful to you and all your colleagues for your help, because you have been instrumental in this journey. I think the pupils are going to give you a lot of the details. And I can tell you one thing, it was not straightforward. I think everyone will agree this is not a straightforward journey. There were many hoops to jump through, gaining permission to launch, looking at the weather, were the conditions right, so many different dates were flying around about when we might launch our weather balloon. And this is before we even think about the complex science involved. And I say we, I mean you. Although this journey had ups and downs, and I'll let them talk to you about that, what's been really developed, and the key point I think I really want to speak about this evening, is the development of their soft skills. And we don't call them soft skills here at Croydon High, because they're not soft at all. They're essential skills. These are what are going to make the difference to our pupils in this complex and challenging world. They learned the importance of teamwork, everyone playing their part, everyone had a specific role, no one could just sit back and let others do it for them. They learned about resilience, when things aren't perfect or when things fail in some way, and adapting to uncertain situations, all the things that life throws at you very regularly. They learned about creative problem solving, and that is to name but a few skills. But in a nutshell, they learned how to set a goal, and the realities of actually getting there. If that's not real world ready, then I don't really know what is. So why is this so important? Why have we invited you all here this evening? And why do we really want to tell you about our journey so far? As we all know, women and girls are really underrepresented in the STEM world, both in higher education and in professions. Less than 30% of scientific researchers worldwide are female, and only 35% of university students in STEM subjects in the UK are women. And there's a huge shortage in these technology disciplines, and women still only account for around 20%, and perhaps 40% of computer science and IT graduates worldwide. The number of girls choosing to study STEM at school has risen in the UK. However, gender bias, perhaps, and discrimination in education, academia, and industry, and a lack of parent-friendly companies and policies have all been cited as reasons as why girls are put off a career in STEM, or why women leave their careers in the field at a faster rate worldwide. And here at Croydon High, we are committed to developing these opportunities to ensure that the girls develop the skills to be successful in this field. And Mission Aspiration, whereby we launched our very own weather balloon, is just the start. We want to change these statistics. Our founding headmistress, I mentioned her earlier, Dorinda Nelligan, I did an assembly actually to the juniors earlier this week about Dorinda, and I put a picture up and I asked the junior school who perhaps they thought this lady was. Queen Mary, Queen Elizabeth I came up, she was quite a statuesque woman looking quite severe perhaps, but she was driven and she was absolutely determined to change the opportunities available for girls. So when Croydon High did open in 1874 with 88 girls in central Croydon, because we weren't on this site then, she was absolutely making sure that the girls had those opportunities. And I have to say, here today, I think if she were here, she'd be 191. I know. I think she'd be incredibly proud, as I am, of our achievements. So as well as aspiration, which is really important, there's also been inspiration. You'll have seen some of our younger pupils here tonight from our junior school, and they have been involved in our Astrogazers mission. And we've also got a specific junior Astrogazers club that's going to start, because this culture of wanting to develop in STEM is really sort of moving forward. We've had our junior pupils go to events such as the Galactic Challenge, whereby we were championed for actually evening out the boy-to-girl ratio. We've had three people launching their own 3D model rocket. So I do feel, a bit like sort of ripples on sort of water, the impact is now becoming far-reaching. Now, as we all know, nothing gets done at a school without a fantastic, inspirational teacher. And I'd like to take this moment to congratulate our own head of physics, Mrs. Arabi Karteepan, whose passion for astronomy, she's just here, let's come forward, I knew you went like this, that's okay, has not only been a driving force behind her teaching, but has also inspired these groundbreaking initiatives. They've captured the imagination of our pupils and the wider community. And Arabi was recently awarded the Royal Astronomical Society's prestigious 2024 Secondary and Further Education Award, recognising her outstanding contributions to promoting astronomy and space science within the educational community. And I really think that deserves a round of applause. I could not be more proud of their combined achievements, and I would really like to thank Mrs. Karteepan for all of her dedication and hard work. You are definitely inspiring our pupils. And I would also say that they are then going to inspire the pupils that are coming up from our younger years. So I could talk for a long time. I've been told that my whole life. So I'm now going to just press pause. Luckily, you get to see me again later. And I would really like to say welcome this evening. Thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedules to be here. I'm now going to pass to Mrs. Karteepan for the next part of the evening. Thank you. I would like to start by saying thank you to everyone who is here tonight with us in person and online to celebrate the success of Mission Aspiration and to also gain an insight into our upcoming mission. I would like to say special thanks to all the pupils at Astrogazers, past and present, for showing a tremendous amount of dedication,
investing a lot of time and effort into the missions. Also, the parents and guardians of the pupils at Astrogazers, who supported us in every possible way, from getting very early in the morning on launch days to ensuring the growth of Astrogazers through word of mouth. And to all the staff at Croydon High, who supported Astrogazers with all forms of logistics, and members of the senior leadership team, for their unwavering support in making the past and present missions run ever so smoothly. And for Annabelle, for her continued enthusiasm and support for every aspect of Astrogazers. And to Catherine, Robert, Claire, Lyndon, and Silva from University of Bath, the guidance and support has been phenomenal. I am forever grateful for the working partnership that we have together. Climb into your seat in the space shuttle and prepare for liftoff. The rocket engines fire and the shuttle thunders into the sky. In seconds, you see the clouds flash by. The air outside gets thinner as the rocket climbs. Suddenly, the air has been left behind and your shuttle is traveling through space. Looking at Earth from space, you can see a fuzzy blue band around its edge. You might notice that the image in the book is no different to the image Astrogazers captured from our payload. This is a page from a book which the five-year-old me read, and it has been a dream come true. Though this happened using a weather balloon and not a rocket, hopefully in the not too distant future, the rocket part will come true. The five-year-old in me will keep on dreaming. That's me at the age of five. I knew before then that I wanted to go to space. If you had asked me what I wanted to be when I grew up, I would have said an astronaut or an astronomer. There were so many space books which inspired me and sparked my curiosity. I would eagerly peer through every space book at home and in the library. I was glad that my dad had a collection of Sir Patrick Moore's books, and I could marvel at the wonders of the universe. For those who may not know who Sir Patrick Moore is, I'll say a few words about him by referring to the information I gathered in 2004. Sir Patrick Moore is an astronomer who has been credited with having done more work than anyone else to raise the profile and understanding astronomy in Britain. Throughout my childhood, I would eagerly watch all the space documentaries and the series on BBC and Channel 4. It became a ritual to watch them, as I wanted to absorb as much information as I possibly could so that I could become a walking encyclopedia about space. At primary school in year two, I surprised a visiting astronomer who came to give a talk about the solar system, and I was able to identify all the planets imaged at various different wavelengths, and I recalled all the key facts about them. I was incredibly excited, and my hand shot up every time to answer questions. Very much like our junior pupils earlier today, shaking their arms to answer questions and to ask questions from a captivating talk given earlier today by Professor Gemma Trill. In year seven, I started collecting scientific newspaper cuttings and shifted to a slightly upgraded collection on printed online space articles. I'm sure you're all thinking this is probably a sign that needed to get out more. I'm sure Robert would agree. In year 12, I started collecting astronomy magazines. I joined the British Astronomical Association and started collecting their magazines too. On a primary school trip to Greenwich Observatory, I bought my first pocket telescope. In sixth form, I was beyond excited when my friends bought me my very own first refractor telescope, and then my husband soon bought me my first Newtonian telescope. And of course, I bought my own pair of binoculars too. I'm yet to buy a computerized telescope. My own physics teacher, Mr. Losby, who is here with us online, borrowed the school telescope for a few weeks. I was quite surprised he trusted me with a small telescope, since during one of my physics practicals, I ended up blowing up an LED in the lab. Bits of glass exploded everywhere. Thankfully, no one was injured. To this day, Mr. Lusby still shares his story in his classroom. So he put a lot of faith in me to look after that telescope. So I was very eager to record my observations through the school telescope, which you can see in this photograph. And Mr. Lusby let me borrow many magazines on space. I might have kept a few. He also arranged for me to attend an inspiring talk about Beagle 2's Mars mission by the late Professor Colin Bluejoy. I fell in love with astrophysics modelling taught by Mr. Lusby, and it was that what was led me to choose my degree. But the natural love of mathematics influenced my degree choice, so I pursued a joint honours at King's College London. So why did I become a teacher? So coming from a family of teachers influenced me deeply and led me on the path I'm currently on. I had multiple experiences during my school life, and as part of my undergraduate ambassador scheme in my final year at university, I taught physics at North London Collegiate School. So this ultimately led me to enter the world of teaching. Accelerating through to my teaching career to arrive at the moment when I started working in Croydon High School, I found myself in an environment where pupils had a passion and an interest in space. I felt that through forming a club, I could provide a platform for the girls to achieve their dreams that the five-year-old in me couldn't achieve. From speaking to the pupils and discussing the possibility of running a space club based on astronomy and astrophysics, they were enthusiastic and encouraged me to start a club. I recognised that I could be the springboard to empower future pupils at Croydon High, like Aria and Anaya, to pursue their dreams in an area which I'm most passionate about, and I could provide the pathway for them to pursue it. So you all met the wonderful Anaya and Aria. They both aspired to be astrophysicists. Knowing that I could enable Aria and Anaya to achieve their dreams in the space industry gives me a sense of fulfillment. So I have no doubt that they will achieve great things and make valuable contributions in the space industry. So the question you may all be thinking is, why did we launch a weather balloon? How did Mission Aspiration come about? In March 2022, I was asked a question by one of the girls. Five simple words formed this question. Could we go to space? My obvious and natural response was, yes, why not? So this conversation sparked the idea of launching a weather balloon to touch the edge of space, and Mission Aspiration was born. I was very keen to give as much responsibility to all the pupils as much as possible, and I wanted them to see that seemingly impossible mission could actually be possible. I was driven to prove to them that if they set their minds to achieve something, it can be done. With Mission Aspiration, all the girls in Astrogazers faced moments of excitement, disappointment, rejections, and a series of challenges. But above all, the most important lesson was failure. The successful launches couldn't have happened without encountering and enduring challenges and failures. I was impressed with the resilience and attitude towards failure. Despite running like a well-oiled machine, the first launch in June was unsuccessful due to the strong wind gusts. This gave us all an opportunity to reflect and improve. Mission Aspiration is proof that with determination and dedication, you can accomplish anything, and that failure does lead to success. The pupils have had a real-world project experience outside of the classroom and have developed lifelong valuable key skills and lessons. The pupils here at Croydon High are exceptional, as you would have already seen from speaking to them, to some of them here tonight. They are confident, hardworking, and inspiring in everything that they do. They worked exceptionally well together to make Mission Aspiration a success. These girls were at the forefront in everything, from making collective decisions, to planning, problem solving, the list goes on. I have never quite come across a collection of people who are so dedicated, committed, and passionate about the work that they set out to do. So I want to share some inspiring stories about some of the members from Astrogazers. I remember when our wonderful former flight director, Tara's there, she ran up to my lab at lunch to see what I was doing with Astrogazers and told me she had heard about the weather balloon launch mission and wanted to be a part of it. She was responsible for expanding the club by recruiting more members and took the initiative to go the extra mile alongside achieving grade 9s in all her GCSE subjects, including physics. I'm sure many of you have met the incredible Isla, stood over there, who is now flight director. She went above and beyond in helping every department within Astrogazers. Not only that, she has also made strategic decisions regarding health and safety, marketing, operations, and she has also been pivotal in inspiring the younger pupils at the junior school. I've never seen a pupil who is so committed and dedicated and multi-talented. Ashka, also stood over there, the amazing assistant flight director, has shown a commitment throughout the mission. She came right after her 3D design GCC examination to work on payload preparation, despite having further examinations the next day. There have been multiple incidents where Ashka overcame crises faced by astrogazers through her quick thinking and problem-solving skills. On the day of the English language GCC examination, Tara, Ashka, and Isla came to see me straight after completing it to work on the payload testing and preparations, despite having a GCC maths examination the next day. With all pupils eventually achieving a grade 9, it just demonstrates how capable, grounded, and dedicated our pupils are. Not only that, I'm also committed to come the following morning after prom to continue preparing for the launch in June. If that doesn't showcase dedication and commitment, I don't know what does. Ashka and Tara sacrificed many days during the summer holidays to come in to prepare for the launches in September. At a time, GCC students were celebrating the end of their journey. These girls were back in school, working on preparations. Their sacrifice and their attitude for going above and beyond is just inspirational. How impressive is that? Above all, every single member of Astrogazers has gone beyond to invest their time and effort during lunch times, after school, holidays, to make the mission a success. I'm sure you would agree with me when I say that every individual member is talented, amazing, and they all deserve a round of applause for the amazing work that they have done and achieved. Aspiration has provided me with moments of pure joy, seeing the girls excited, happy, full of confidence, and displaying a can-do attitude. The impact of Mission Aspiration's success has forever spreading and growing, and I'm very proud of Astrogazers for inspiring the younger generation within our school community, and to hear casual, normalised conversations in the corridors about the weather balloon launch and a satellite launch. And it's just amazing. This is starting to send a very strong message that girls can achieve things that were once thought impossible. Astrogazers' missions provide proof that girls who aspire without limits can achieve what they set out to do. Not only that, we have also been committed to inspire others beyond the school community, particularly other young people, by creating a series of how-to guides on a YouTube channel. I recently visited the Lightroom in central London to experience Moonwalkers, a journey with Tom Hanks. It was a fantastic and emotive experience, a must visit for all space enthusiasts. Tears rolled down my eyes while I watched and listened to President John F. Kennedy's We Choose to Go to the Moon speech, which he delivered on September 12, 1962. I'd like to echo a few words from the infamous speech. But why, some say, the moon? Why choose this as our goal? We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do other things. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skill. Because that challenge is one that we are willing to accept. One we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win, and others too. 61 years later, on that very same day, September 12, 2023, Astrogazers chose to go to space and succeeded. This time, we choose to go higher. We choose to go higher than the stratosphere. We choose to go into low Earth orbit. I'm now going to pass over to astrogazers who will share their journey through mission Aspiration. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Karteepan, for that. I'm genuinely quite lost for words. I hadn't heard that speech before, and I'm very honoured. We are thrilled to see so many of you here tonight to walk you through the journey we took with Mission Aspiration. It has been a busy experience, as Ms. Karteepan has said, filled with ups and downs and so many memorable moments, from meeting in the holidays to getting our first subscribers on YouTube. So thank you for coming along to hear our story. When we first came up with the idea that instead of simply looking at space, we could travel to it, we all thought it was crazy. In our eyes, space was reserved for the high-tech companies such as NASA and ESA with their astronauts and rovers. Many of us had never even heard of weather balloons before, let alone aim to launch one. So naturally, the first meetings after the decision were populated with research. What is a weather balloon? What materials would we need? How much would it cost? How do we actually go about launching one? We spent many sessions researching these questions, and slowly, week by week, we became more aware of how much work would have to go in. As our list of required equipment kept growing, with it, so did the cost. We finally sourced all the equipment and materials we'd been researching for the past months. So now we had a set cost, we had a complete set of equipment, and we had a plan in our mind. So we were ready also to pitch to the SLT for funding. A short persuasion later, we realized that our mission might actually be achievable. We had the funding, we had the kit, now we had the hope. However, we soon realized there was still a lot to do. Where would we launch? How would we launch? What about the risks?
So we got back to research. We researched far and wide, from blogs to YouTube videos, to find out how we would launch our weather balloon. We found that there were three parts in this: assembly, launching, and retrieving. We were before the assembly stage at this point. The more we looked, the more success stories we found with weather balloon launches in the US and from mainland Europe. However, a few could be found from the UK. It turned out that launching a weather balloon, difficult enough as it was, had added difficulties to overcome in the UK simply because the chance of a weather balloon landing on land was quite low. Not only did our launch site have to have a low chance of landing on land, we also had to think about the wind gusts and multiple variables which may have affected our actual launch. We had to avoid the payload flying over a restricted area and airspace too. What's more, it wasn't just the location that affected the trajectory. It's also the time of year, which is why the wind gusts and the wind speed would affect the launch. But we weren't going to let that stop us. We spent over 11 months tracking weather and potential flight paths at different times in the day from a range of locations across the UK. We collected a large wealth of data which allowed us to conclude when and where would be the best for our launch. Another issue that arose from our research was helium. Yes, as it turned out, there was a global shortage of helium. We contacted many major suppliers and even some hearted moon-filling companies to try and source any helium we could. Any helium we could was extremely costly, which obviously added to our cost.
But those issues were mainly experimental issues, ones that you could see arising when thinking about the practicalities of launching a weather balloon. But there were other things to consider. Mr. Nelson, our Director of Finance and Operations, and Mr. Taylor, our Facilities and Health and Safety Manager, ensured that a risk assessment for the weather balloon launch had been considered. We spent months researching all the possible risks and hazards involved. This prompted us to factor the possible dangers and challenges we could face when planning the method for the launch. The final document was extensive, to say the least, in considering every single possible risk in all stages of the mission. We also made the decision that it would be best to partner with the university to assist us in the launch. After a while of approaching different institutions, we contacted Professor Catherine Mitchell, and we are so grateful that both she and Dr. Robert Watson took the time to respond and meet us on a Teams call.
By now, we had invested a lot of time, effort, and money into the weather balloon and our mission. So we weren't going to send it up without assurance that what was inside would be trackable and retrievable. To ensure this, we bought GPS trackers and carried out functionality tests. We tested the tracking interval, how long goes between each location recording, to see which would be best when retrieving the payload. Our GPS functionality was, to be honest, slightly unreliable. We tested the GPS trackers by walking near buildings and trees to see if we could detect our payload, if it might land near obstructions. And finally, we decided to have two GPS trackers to maximise our chances of finding our payload. We were unsure if the GPS tracker would turn back on upon its descent, if it had stopped working at high altitude due to the low temperatures. Therefore, we tested the GPS trackers in cold environments.
We also included a Bluetooth tail tracker, which would allow us to hear ringing when we were within a certain range of the payload. We hoped that this would help us be able to detect the payload in case it landed in dense vegetation where we couldn't see it. So now we knew we could track it successfully. But what was the point in ensuring we could retrieve it if we were certain that our equipment wouldn't fail? Well, there were two main things that we wanted from the flight: video footage of the edge of space and data from throughout the journey. We bought a data logger and carried out functionality tests. The data logger was mainly used to take measurements including altitude, temperature, humidity, and pressure. We got an 8mm camera to use to capture our footage. The sheer excitement we had after viewing our first piece of footage was a truly memorable experience. It was truly mesmerizing.
Getting approval from the Civil Aviation Authority to launch was difficult, as we received approval only 14 hours before the proposed launch window. We carried on as planned, having the minibus and equipment ready for departure at 5 a.m. Preparation and organisation were key to making the launch day as smooth as possible to minimise the issues arising from the CAA's late notice. When the approval was given, the launch was on. The next day, we all gathered at school ready for the 3-hour drive to get to Bath. We all got into the minibus, undeniably tired from the early morning start, but all buzzing with excitement and anticipation for the day ahead. We arrived at Bath and rushed to the field in preparation for the launch. We had anticipated several problems, from filling up the weather balloon with helium to retrieving the payload stuck in a tree. We had found ways to mitigate the anticipated problems too. Having the University of Bath team handle the helium and having a tree pruning stick to get the payload out of a tree.
However, what we hadn't anticipated were the issues of the wind gusts. Unfortunately, due to strong wind gusts, our release cord and parachute cord twisted. The friction caused by this resulted in the parachute cord breaking and our payload falling back to the ground. There are many variables that affect a weather balloon launch, and these are no different to the variables that affect space agencies around the world when they launch their rockets. We moved back inside to discuss our next steps, reviewing each and every team member's input on the day. We had an honest reflection of what went well and what we could have done better, and found ways to improve the launch to maximise our success. So we decided to launch two medium-sized weather balloons instead of the large one we initially used. This meant that our payload mass was split between two rather than one.
It was a challenge to fit our items into two separate payloads, with strict mass restrictions in place. Mrs. Karteepan ensured that we measured every centimetre of tape and recorded every gram of each item. This allowed us to fit all the desired components within both payloads and ensured we had enough leeway for any additions decided for on the day. For example, we decided that instead of using Karteepan logos and QR codes, we would print them on paper. Seemingly small changes like this had a massive impact on our period masses. But that wasn't the only thing to consider. Ella had the practical knowledge about knots and what type of knots would be best to prevent the pulls from unraveling and snapping. With this, we were confident that the connection points from the payload to the parachute and from the parachute to the balloon was secure. We also applied for a longer launch window from the CAA to ensure that we would make flexible decisions based on weather data.
Long for Astrogazers to jump into action and start planning for the upcoming launches. We bought a new kit to start building two Generation 2 payloads, each named after a pioneering female figure in STEM. The payloads were named Sharman and Belvinel. We wanted to take advantage of the favorable wind speeds that were offered in September before the average wind speed increased closer to autumn. We were dedicated and committed into attending weekly meetings during the summer holidays, and we even came in to build the Generation 2 payloads.
So, on the 4th of September, the inset day before school started up for the new year, we were in school, running a Mission Aspiration practice launch. An exact run through of how we would hope the launch would go on the day. Mrs. Karteepan had devised a minute by minute plan indicating each member's role in the launch. Being a double sided A3 sheet, it was incredibly detailed and thorough. Much more in depth than we had before. I know, no pressure. We had rehearsed many, many, many times to build muscle memory. Meaning that at the end of the day, everyone knew exactly what they were doing and when. There was not missing anything out that day, and absolutely everything that we would be doing on launch day was done. From the main payload assembly to live stream speeches and take team tactics. And finally, after 7 hours of intense practicing and focus, we were ready for Mission Aspiration to launch.
We had planned an early September launch, but a Atlantic weather front with unfavourable winds meant that the first week was out of bounds. With our launch date rescheduled, we faced a mix of anticipation and anxiety. Over the next week, wind conditions had improved and the rain remained a possibility and was a potential concern. Finally, we'd set a launch date. Tuesday, the 12th of September. Yet again, we all gathered at school in the early hours, ready to go. We arrived at the University of Bath, and the weather seemed in our favour. We were ready to start preparations. The weather prospects darkened as weather warnings rolled in. Nevertheless, we remained composed and well prepared for the mission. The payload team assembled Belvinel with a remarkable 15 minutes to spare. Meanwhile, the weather team diligently monitored wind speeds and tracked payload trajectories. The marketing team had everything in place, setting up a flawless live stream at the start. The countdown began and we all experienced a roller coaster of emotions, desperate hope that nothing goes wrong and the launch will be a success. But all fear and trepidation was soon replaced with excitement and thrill as the payload soared into the sky. Cheers and shrieks of delight erupted as we watched it rise until it was a mere dot. But we still couldn't wait about. We still had the Sharman payload to launch.
After the successful launch of the Belvinel payload, we were confident that we could obtain the same outcome with the Sharman payload. But tragedy soon struck. The two GPS trackers we planned to use failed to respond. Seemingly to further discourage us, the sky opened above us and it started to rain. It felt for a moment that all odds were against us. However, it was only for a moment. We found a solution. Having a backup GPS tracker that hadn't yet been activated proved to be useful. Since we had plenty of experience assembling the payload, we were able to activate the GPS, call Mr. King, authorize the subscription, and attach it to the payload loop all within the planned time. Ari and Ava quickly set up the GPS tracker, and our Charmin payload was ready to go. Following the same pattern as before, we launched the Charmin payload, and before we knew it, we had another Astrogazer weather balloon in the sky.
We returned to the building to have lunch, but we could only rest and celebrate for only a minute, as we had to track the payloads. Whilst we monitored both sites simultaneously and in real time, due to its early launch, Belle Burnell was set to land first. Our flight predictor had indicated a course towards Oxford, and the GPS tracker provided the real-time positions updates every 3 minutes, confirming its journey towards South Oxfordshire. When the payload came closer to its final moments of descent, we contacted local businesses who might have any detail about accessing land, and soon we stumbled upon Mr. Howard Harwood, Mr. Paul Harwood, who kindly helped us in accessing the landing site of the Belle Burnell payload. In order to be able to retrieve both payloads on the day, we decided to separate into two teams. Mr. Carsey and Mr. Ting were sent to retrieve the Belle Burnell payload, while the rest of our team made our way to the predicted location of the Charmin payload. We will never forget the sacrifices that Mr. Carsey had to endure for Mission Aspiration. Thankfully, he was not hurt. Mr. Carsey had to swing through a hedge to access the land where the Belle Burnell payload had landed.
Back at Bath, we eagerly tracked the Charmin payload. It was nerve-wracking, and we were all anxious as it got closer to its landing time, as our payload came perilously close to landing near busy roads or even in the River Thames. However, we soon determined that the Charmin payload had landed in the privately owned Lockwood Forest. We got into the minibus to start chasing the payload, but we struggled to get in contact with the landowner, meaning that accessing it would be impossible. Despite this, we continued to drive towards South Oxfordshire. En route, Mrs. Karteepan received a call from Anna, who was working in the Lockwood Forest. To our astonishment, he reported that he had stumbled upon the payload. It was a stroke of luck that led him back to an area of the forest where he needed to clear the branch, a decision that otherwise wouldn't have taken him to that spot. Our payload might have remained undiscovered. Just as Andy was about to fell a tree, which would have directly crushed our payload, he noticed its bright red parachute. Curious, he stepped away from his machinery, only to find the parachute connected to the payload, perfectly seated on a tree stump. The payload was a few meters away from the River Thames, and the sights had signs of warning and danger due to life tree fellings. Andy had spent a month at Lockwood Forest and was in his final week there, meaning there would be no one on site thereafter. Additionally, the surrounding area was privately owned, making the access seemingly impossible. You would never guess where we met Andy in order to retrieve the payload. A Tesco car park. It was a series of unexpected events and circumstances that led us to recover the Charmin payload. We were seemingly blessed with good fortune with our retrievals. There were so many near misses and anticipated dangers that it is nothing short of a miracle that both were retrieved intact and with ample data too.
There were quite a few common devices and components for both payloads as they were necessary for tracking and retrieving them. These devices included a GPS spot tracker, a Bluetooth tower tracker, a few QR codes and logos were also added in order for anyone who might have found the payload to contact us. This proved extremely useful during retrieval of the Charmin payload. Here's a short video showing some of the components that have been our payloads.
Thank you.
testing materials and required devices, we did have other things within our payload. Catherine had acknowledged that this would be a once-in-a-lifetime experience for us all, and so Ms. Karteepan had organised a few mementos to be included within the valve in our payload. A USB stick of e-tickets containing the names of multiple students from a range of years were sent to space, which allowed us to fully connect with the school community. With the names, we sent a memoir, a poem and a drawing of the late Emma and Letty Patterson. Mrs. Patterson was a huge supporter of all of us, the aspiring girls. She was always encouraging all the students in the school and believed we could reach great heights, and so it was only right to take her with us. Obviously, our first course of action after getting the payload back was to see what data we had collected, and that was our first success. Seeing the real footage that our weather balloon had taken on its journey, seeing the curve of our planet below, and knowing that we managed to make that happen was more than magical. We shared our story on YouTube and Instagram with genuine footage that we took. Others noticed what we had achieved, and as you can see, our story got published. The Institute of Engineering and Technology, the University of Bath, space.com, and numerous others published our story, detailing Mission Aspiration and showing the work we had done. During the next Astrogazers session, we were given little mementos from the mission, silver ivy charms that had touched the edge of space. You might have seen many of us wearing those today. They had gone up in the payload and were a little part of space that we could keep with us, forever to remember the experience and remind us that not even the sky is the limit. And obviously, we can't ignore the wonderful and much-deserved award received by our very own Mrs. Karteepan to acknowledge all that she has done to further physics education for not just us girls and Astrogazers, but all the students she teaches. Mrs. Karteepan has been and will continue to be a true inspiration for us, all helping young girls take their first steps into the world of STEM. We could not have been more proud.
So now we're just going to have a quick 15-minute refreshment break. So, yeah. Refresh yourself.
Thank you.
Achievements, but also by the articulate way that the pupils are talking about it, so they've been very proud. So, what is next? That is the question. And this next part of the evening is for us to talk to you about our next mission. And that mission is Mission Pegasus. So are you ready to hear the details? Fabulous. So, we're really proud to announce that Astrogazers, in partnership with the University of Bath, will become the first UK school to launch a CubeSat into space. Mission Pegasus aims to answer the question, what can observing the sun's spectral wavelengths tell us about the Earth's atmosphere. And I'm not going to go into too many details because that's for the pupils to tell you. But looking at the atmospheric effects of the transmission of solar radiation is one. And pupils will learn how our climate and pollution in the atmosphere can be investigated using instrumentation that pupils will design, build and test. The investigations will be conducted from the ground and a weather balloon. At this moment, they're going to take a minute. Because Mrs. Karteepan came to my office to tell me about the potential next mission, actually with an A3 sheet, but with a lot of things written in very small lines. And one of those lines said, launch a weather balloon. And you know when you think to yourself, we have gone from this amazing start where launching our weather balloon was our one goal for a year, to actually, or more than a year, sorry, 18 months and beyond, to actually having this amazing goal whereby launching a weather balloon is just one line of an A3 sheet. And I think that shows you how much we believe in both the pupils, but also in the abilities that we will get there. And of course, there will be failures. So, outcomes for learning. Why are we doing this? So our pupils learn and they get some amazing experiences. Obviously, undertaking scientific research, setting up the experiments, measuring atmospheric pollution, analysing the data and design, building and testing, and making sure that everything is ready and you can actually measure that data. Interpret and analyse the data in order to answer that specific question and how to relate their scientific findings to climate science. So it's ambitious and it's bold, and it's very much in line with our school vision, which is for our girls to aspire without limits. And I hope you'd agree that in this project, we are definitely fulfilling this aim. And it's going to take a lot for this project to become a reality, and our team is already growing. Mr. Matthew White, he's one of our phenomenal senior school parents, and he runs his own IT service company. And actually, he came up to me in an evening at the very start of the year, one of our welcome evenings, and put this idea into my head. And I thought to myself, my goodness, I know that the Astrogazers and Mrs. Karteepan will be very interested in this. So a big thank you to you for the next part of our inspirational journey. And we're also going to be working with Croydon High alumna Hannah Schmidt. And when she left the University of Cambridge, having completed her undergraduate degree and Masters in Mechanical Engineering, she's gone on to be a Senior Strategy Engineer for championship-winning Formula One team Red Bull. So she brings a wealth of knowledge in so many areas, including problem solving and data analysis, and we are so grateful for her and for her support. And I do remember back in that first month of my appointment, as I said, when the girls came to the office, and I thought to myself, that's an amazing idea, and I watched them achieve it. I absolutely know there'll be many failures along the way, but that this mission, Mission Pegasus, will be another huge success for our pupils of Croydon High. So I'm now going to pass over to Mrs. Karteepan and the Astrogazers to tell you a bit more about Mission Pegasus. Thank you.
Right, so just before Astrogazers and I do go on to talk a little bit about Mission Pegasus, I'd like to invite Professor Catherine Mitchell and Dr. Robert Watson to share their thoughts and views on Mission Aspiration.
Thank you very much, thank you. So, this email here, which I put up on the screen with permission from Tara, was the very first contact that I had from Croydon High School. And you can see it is an extraordinarily friendly and professional and polite email to come from somebody that's in school. In fact, it's an email that you would be impressed with if it came from somebody working in your organisation. And I read it through and I thought, oh, that sounds really interesting. I wonder how serious they are. And I read it again and I thought, from everything I can ascertain from reading this email, these are very serious people about what they want to achieve. And that's as much information as I have, really. And if you look at the date of the email, And Professor Gemma Actual will understand what I'm going to say about it. The date of the email was 17th of January of 2023. And in fact, it's just a little over a week after myself, Dr. Robert Watson, Dr. Talini Pinto Jayawardena, Professor Gemma Actual, and many of our former students from the University of Bath and PhD students stood out in Cornwall to wait for the very first UK launch of a bunch of UK satellites and many other people. And it was an incredibly uplifting and exciting evening. It was freezing. It was really, really exciting. And I stood there looking at this spacecraft, that this airplane out on the runway that was going to launch a bunch of satellites into space and an innovative new rocket launch coming from an airplane. And I felt for the first moment in my entire career that I was going to touch the edge of space, because something that we had built within the university was going to go into space. And we had this incredibly elated moment where we heard that the first stage of the rocket had succeeded, and then crushing, I can only describe it as crushing news to hear that the rocket had launched up into space and had failed to go into orbit and was coming back down in frequency. And so you can imagine the mood I was in when I had to RSVP. I was still feeling pretty low after that event. And I have to say that part of what motivated me to respond was the professionalism of her email. But the other thing, which I think is a really, really good lesson to hold on to, which I've held on to throughout my whole career, is that fear of failure is not a reason to say no. And I was really, really scared when I thought about supporting the school to do the balloon launch that we might have a failure. And not only would that failure be on my shoulders, but it would be on the shoulders pushed down to young people. And that was a genuine fear as we went forward. And I'll hand over to Robert for the next part.
Thank you, Catherine. I think you've already heard the balloon story from probably the most important people, and that is the pupils themselves. So I'm going to be very brief and just give you our perspective from the university. So we heard early on about soft skills, essential skills. I won't call them soft skills ever again, I promise. And I must say that the first balloon attempt, I almost had this fear that, okay, so we can do this, we can get the balloon up, but we've never done this with children from school, with the school before. And there's a bit of a difference between our expectations, maybe our own students and our own staff, and doing it with other people. So first of all, helium. Well, it turns out we've got tons of helium. We've got so much helium, you wouldn't believe how much helium. So we had plenty of helium. So that, we heard about the helium stories and it didn't apply to us. There was a small matter of the fact that the balloon was probably a little bit bigger on the first go than we were expecting. So I think between Claire, myself and Catherine, we'd launched hundreds of balloons. But they were carrying traditional weather sondes, so small devices, probably as big as a paperback book, in most cases no bigger than a fist. We were now talking about launching something that was 1.6 kilos. That needed a very, very big weather balloon. In fact, I don't know if you've ever seen a weather balloon, but if you unpack a weather balloon, it's covered in powder, just like a cornstarch, designed to stop it from sticking together. Well, you try filling one of those when the wind is gusting and buffeting around, we look like we'd fallen in the vats of flour. So, I hadn't anticipated that, nobody told me that, I didn't sign up for that. Anyway, so that was the first part. So having the gust certainly made it very difficult to actually fill. But we got there in the end. So Claire always downplays her part in this, but actually Claire helped us out no end in terms of filling the gas. So the very large gas cylinder that you see there, anybody that knows about handling compressed gases knows how dangerous those cylinders can be if you don't know, if you like, the care and feeding of gas cylinders and the proper regulators that you need and everything else to go on. So I'm very, very grateful for Claire for sorting out, and Siva as well, for helping us through that process. So we've heard about the sort of the failed first attempt, and I guess the thing that I took away from that was just everyone, yes, just as Catherine said, we were crushed with the failure of the launch down in Cornwall. Although it was obvious that everyone was really, we put all that effort in and this has just happened. The payload is just as you've seen from the video footage, just dropped back down. But what was really, really professional, and what I could scarcely believe that that's what was happening, was that everybody got together, everybody worked out what worked, what didn't work, and everyone took part in, it's basically what's known as failure modes and effects analysis, if you like, in the grown-up space industry. But everybody jumped in on that. Everybody was included in that process. Mrs. K went round the room, literally asking everybody what they did well, what they think could have improved, all of the problems, all the teething issues that we'd experienced on the day, even though we'd actually got everything together and launched it, all of those were analysed. So you can see the details of absolutely, I think that is in fact at least one copy of the double-sided A3 spreadsheet, the aforementioned article. The photo there in the middle is me, I don't know quite what I'm doing, but I appear to be holding a weather balloon that I'm drawn to angle. At this point, we perfected pretty much how you fill a weather balloon. All we needed was the girls to get the payload ready on time. And boy, did they do that this time. Absolutely nailed it. Because from the first mission, we realised, we in the collective sense of the girls realised that actually, it's not just a case of putting some stuff in a box and taping it. Well, it is, but you try doing that to a very tight schedule and actually making that happen. And I think there was a dedicated tape team established to work out exactly how much tape is needed, not too much. Again, I think Mrs. K gave them strict instructions that more tape equals more mass equals bad. You know, that's a very simple physics problem that we needed to resolve. And they really, really, absolutely nailed it. So I think on reflection, the biggest moment that I have is, yes, we went away and we understood the twisting issue and we understood why and how that happened. And the girls came up with a whole bunch of solutions, looking at it through binoculars to make sure that the launch cord wasn't twisted. Eventually, even though we made all those efforts, actually the launch cord still got twisted, but we'd got a backup plan. So our backup plan was the hand launch, which is what we eventually did. And the last words I remember when the balloon went off, I said, that's not coming down again. And Miss Kay looked at me like, what do you mean it's not coming? I said, it's not coming back down in this field. It's coming back down. And so that, at that point, I think, I just thought, we can do this again. And we did. And you've heard from the girls about the fact that, yeah, I used that as an umbrella, sitting there underneath holding it, but we launched again. So handing back to Catherine.
To finish off, there's a couple of reflections, but just before I go on to these, the first thing that I wanted to reflect on to emphasise to everybody is that the thing that deeply impressed me most of all, and there's many, many things that have impressed me about recording high school girls, but the thing that most deeply impressed me was the fact that right after the first launch failure, they realised that they still had the opportunity to grill myself and Robert about all the physics questions they had prepared for us on that day. And they stepped up to going through their planned process right through. And it takes an incredible person to be able to put aside their upsets from the day and to get on with something that's the bigger picture. And to me, to watch them do that was absolutely phenomenal. because I can tell you they didn't half give us some brilliant on some physics that day. And I can remember, for physicists here, I can remember one of the questions that came up, and it was directed at my engineer colleague here, Robert Watson, was, Dr. Watson, if the photon doesn't have any mass, how does it get bent as it goes through the gravitational field? And Robert looked across at me and just went, what? So these were not simple questions, these were deeply thought out questions that they had for us. And to step up and do that at that moment, I just thought was a phenomenal sense of the character of the people we were working with. And just to give a few lessons that I've learned, I think the first one that I've learned from the girls is really how to manage failure constructively. You know, right after the first failure of the launch, what they saw was a group hug that happened straight away with the teacher and the girls. And basically, I heard this shout of, what would NASA do now? I said, what NASA would do now? And apparently what NASA would do now was they would pick themselves up again and plan for the next mission. And that's exactly what the girls did. So I learned how they supported each other and handled that. Taking calculated risks as well. I think that for me to understand that you can't predict everything, that we had to make some improvisations in order to make this a success. But we were doing that in a way that we were following the rules, we were sticking to all the health and safety and everything, but at the end of the day we had to do some small improvisations in order to make this launch work. It was nice after the experience with the Virgin Orbit launch, it was nice to know what success feels like. Thank you girls for giving us that experience. When you shared with us some of the footage from space, it was just amazing. It made my heart jump the very first time I opened one of those videos, and you could see how high those balloons had launched and look at the camera in space. It was amazing. And I just think that what we're seeing now, we're not seeing a group of girls who are coming into STEM that will be the next generation of space scientists. We're seeing a group of girls who already are our next generation of space scientists. And what I'm seeing there is that they already have all the skills that we're looking for in order to come through into those jobs. So to me, that's really, really exciting to see. And I'd just like to finish just to say that the credit goes to Croydon High School. It is at a really special school. And I think that all of the girls here and the parents will know already. But when you look back on this, you will realise what a very, very special environment we're working in. And it's been a real pleasure for us to be involved with you. So thank you.
Mentioned a bit about our next missions, but just go over it again because it's very important. So, on the 12th of September, the day of Mission Aspirations, where the balloon launched, Mrs. Davies was speaking to the Year 8 parents in the hall, explaining why Mr. Carty and Mrs. Karteepan couldn't be there. Mr. White, a parent at Croydon High School, upon hearing about Astrogazers' Mission Aspiration, then proposed the idea of launching a CubeSat to Miss Davies. Miss Davies passed this idea on to Mrs. Karteepan, and you can probably guess by now, without a doubt, what Miss Karteepan's reaction was. A very excited yes. So we decided collectively on a name for the mission, and named it after one of the great constellations in the night sky. And so, Mission Pegasus was born. We aimed to launch our very own cube satellite into low Earth orbit to measure the sun's wavelength and see what it can tell us about the Earth's atmosphere. We leapt from looping at space to sending a physical object there. Surely it's not as big a job to send a satellite into orbit.
Just like to mention one thing about the logos that you see here for Mission Aspiration, Mission Pegasus, Mission IV satellites. They've all been designed by a wonderful art scholar and design engineer, Ella, who's sat over there. She's a fabulous artist, and she has single-handedly created our beautiful logos. She's created a beautiful panel on one of the display walls over there, showing the progression of a very small girl at junior school, going through senior school to then to progress to become an astronaut, which was one of my dreams. So thank you so much, Ella. You're incredibly good. Mission Pegasus. We do not underestimate the demands of Mission Pegasus, but the lessons learnt from Mission Aspiration will prove vital to rise to significant fundraising challenges, respond to other inevitable challenges that we will encounter, and most importantly, learn from our failings. I want to share a memory of the very first moment I revealed a new mission to Astrogazers. Everyone sat down quietly with high levels of anticipation. I took my time, paused, and then revealed that we would be launching a cube satellite into low Earth orbit. The reaction, the screams and happiness in the room was unforgettable. And this is my fuel to see this mission through to its full completion. I was incredibly proud that they unanimously accepted this mission with a can-do attitude, rather than a more tentative response to mission aspiration. To see this self-belief and confidence blossom has been so uplifting for all of us. I very much look forward to the next steps that we will take with Mission Pegasus and to bring a wider school community with us in partnership with our remarkable allies at the University of Bath, and we hope with so many more friends that we have made on this journey. There are so many distinguished guests here tonight, and we are so grateful that you have joined us to share our celebration and also our vision of the future. We know we need a great deal of support in a number of areas to continue our mission, and we hope to be able to have the opportunity to work and learn from many of you. As we move forward, we are inspired by the words of Dame Jocelyn Bell Bunnell, who we named one of our payloads after, who, if not for her diary that it was completely booked for the next 9 months, would I believe would be here tonight with us. Jocelyn said, "Take risks." We are inspired by the words of her. So take risks, to dare to think differently. This is where true innovation lies. And she also said, "Science is not limited to a particular gender, age, or background. It is for everyone." At Croydon High, we have a saying, "Great minds think differently." And this, for me, sums up what our real mission is: to think differently, think creatively, and to inspire young, great minds who have been constrained far too long by their gender, their background, or their opportunities to go out and achieve. The aim is to encourage the girls at Croydon High to aspire without limits and to inspire other young people. So thank you all for your attention tonight and for your support now and in the future.
We're very grateful for your presence here tonight, so we can share our journey of Mission Aspiration with you. Thank you so much for attending our event. We hope you've enjoyed our story as much as we enjoyed creating it, and we look forward to sharing our progress of Mission Pegasus with you. Please do follow us on Instagram and subscribe to our YouTube channel to get the latest updates. There are QR codes on your tables, so please do scan them.
If you would like to reach out or collaborate with us, please, please, please get in touch with Mrs. Karteepan. We would be delighted for you to help us with Mission Pegasus, and we hope that you have had an enjoyable time, and we look forward to seeing you again sometime. At Croydon High, girls aspire without limits. We choose to go to the edge of space. We chose to go into low Earth orbit. Sorry, it's a tongue twister. It sounds all weird. We chose to go into low Earth orbit, and we will continue to grow, aspire, and reach an even greater height than before.
However, before you go, we have a few very special thank yous to make. First of all, we would love to thank Catherine. She is the very reason we are standing here today talking about Mission Aspiration. She has believed in us since the beginning, And she continues to do so. We are so grateful for all she has done for us. Thank you.
And of course to Robert, who has supported our mission and encouraged us. And as you can tell from his short speech just before, he was very funny and made us laugh along the way.
We cannot forget the rest of the wonderful University of Bath team, Siva, Claire and Lyndon, who offered so much insight and time to us, particularly on launch day. We're so grateful. Thank you.
Thank you to Mrs. Davies. Without her support, we wouldn't have been able to launch at all. She has believed in us since the very first SLT meeting we had and has not stopped since. Thank you. And of course, we're not going to forget Mrs. Karteepan. She has no idea what we're about to say, so.
She was the very, we cannot forget the very first person who is the foundation of Astrogazers. Mrs. Karteepan has no doubt been ambitious. There have been many times where we all thought that it couldn't be achieved. However, time and time again, she proved that we should believe in ourselves. And she has shown that we're capable of doing anything when we put our minds to it. So thank you so much. You're an inspiration to us all. Thank you very much and have a safe journey home.
Thank you.
So I do believe we've finished 15 minutes ahead of time. So you can take this wonderful opportunity to, again, ask us questions, speak to the girls, and find out more about Mission Pegasus, and or if you'd like to go home, you can go home.